I'm French, so I have a broken English. I hope it will be helpful that you may understand me. I'm not American, I'm not English, English is not my native language. I understand Farida told me that you are all students in art. Yes? No?
No.
Audience? No. But mainly the young. I am going to deal with it. In fact, it's a complicated question, but I try to make it simple. My proposal is to speak not more than 1 hour, even less, and to let you ask questions if I know the answer. I will give you the answer. If not, you're going to look for the answer on the internet or somewhere else. What interests me and what I think is very interesting in the work of Mark Bloch, the paper, is that the way how we deal with abstraction. You know, because of his paintings, that he was not an abstract painter all his life, he became an abstract after the war. In two stages, one which is we call multiform painting, which you have seen then, or if you have seen my film, you can see multiform painting, which is colors, not organized in a very clear way, but we can say that we don't know what it's telling about. It's not figures, it's not human figures, it's not, it's abstract. And after the very famous period, which looks like the Latvian flag with the colors, it's for me, I'm sure there is a connection. the colors and the idea that everything is flat and horizontal, like here. When I went here for the first time, I saw everything is horizontal. And I say, okay, Rocco is coming from this place. What is first? What was said about abstraction, and second time, what I say about it. I'm going to tell you when it's my opinion, and to tell you when it's obvious, when it's clear, we have proof. He was born there. You know that. When I came the last time. I made a lecture also. It's quite difficult to explain that Rocco was a Jewish painter. Why? Because there are a lot of Jewish painters in this area. Chagall, Cohen, the other one, I forget the name. Soutine, and but that's very important for our question, especially if you want to be artist and you are dealing with the question of figures or abstraction, figurative or abstract paper. That, let's say Chagall, everybody knows, I think he was born in Vitebsk, is going and painting goats and persons on the roof and with a fiddle. We see images and figures, really realistic. But Chagall, for me it was important, I'm quite a suspicious guy, and I tried to understand why he's painting like that. He didn't know Hebrew. He read the Bible in Yiddish, which is a popular language of the population here. Popular language. Not the main cultural language, which was not the language, which is Hebrew. And he was a popular guy, living in a popular area. After that he turned, I'm speaking about Chagall, he turned to be a communist. He was close to the population. And the question of abstraction didn't reach him. But Rocco, Mark Rokovic, was born here in Latvia. And his environment, he went to the Jewish school, the Hebrew school, and then when he went to the States, he was 10. He went also to learn Hebrew, and he was used to take his mother to the synagogue, and after that he worked with a rabbi making the drawings of Bibles. But what is the difference between Rothko and Chagall? Not only 100 kilometers. But Chagall was popular and Rothko was an intellectual. And it's hard to believe perhaps, but this area was the area of the intellectual Jews. Gaon von Vilna, Levinas, I'm going to speak about this philosopher, which is now very famous, by the name of Levinas, who wrote about art, very interesting things. I'm not sure you can find it in English, but perhaps. And the son of the painter, Christopher Rothko, went a few years ago giving a lecture in the place where I used to live and made a colloquium about Levinas, and Rothko. And Levinas, you can hear, that's the name from this place. Levinas was born in Kaunas. It's close. An artist, also with the same problems as Rothko, was born in Riga. And the part between, let's say, Vitebsk and Danube, is a frontier between popular Jews, he said Hasidic, singing and dancing all the time. You can see it in the movies. And the intellectual Jews who were learning and teaching Bible and Talmud all the time. And Rothko is an intellectual. And because he is an intellectual, he is abstract. Because it's not the only reason. I have to tell you also why he is a Jewish abstract. But he's an abstract because he's dealing with ideas. He said there is no good painting about nothing. What is to say? He was answering to the other painters who were abstract, but formalist. They were looking for forms, and the moment it looks good, with a good way to have red and blue, and like Kandinsky or other, he said, or Malevich or other, they used to say, it's good. But they were formalist. It was painting about, say, work or about nothing. Painting about painting. You look at your painting and you say, it fits well. It's abstract, but it fits well. Rothko said, there is no good painting about nothing. And what was his problem? The ideas. He was a philosopher. He was reading not only the Bible and the Talmud, but Platon, Nietzsche, all the main philosophers. And after he read Schopenhauer, let's say, he was painting. It's very difficult to paint ideas. Very difficult, try it. You have not a figure, not somebody, a model, or something, but an idea. How to paint an idea. And he was this kind of man. He was disturbed, his torment was idea. What kind of idea? Mainly how to get a collectivity of viewers unite by the painting. You have two ways, more or less, to have a collectivity of viewers. One, it's like with Mona Lisa, or your painting, I don't know. A lot of persons are coming, looking at one painting, and it's like in a church. They unite, and they say, we feel together because we are looking at the same painting. There was one painting, and one sculpture, going to speak about painting, about a figure. And they say, like in a church, we are unique, there is one figuration, and we are 100, if you are going to see Mona Lisa in the Louvre, 500 or 1,000. It's like a collectivity, that you have only one image. Mark Rothko said, if I want to unite person and use the image to do it, I have to put a lot of images and one person in the middle. to surround the person. We call it a Rothko room. He made it in the States, he made it in London. London, he wasn't there. And he's building a place, and putting the paintings around the person. And you can feel, in this case, that the paintings are giving you an idea. I'm going to tell you what kind of idea, because I'm an abstract painting. What kind of idea? But the main worry was to use art as a way to be instead philosophy or instead literature, to make a collectivity. Let's say the person who are moved, who have emotion with the work of painting, it's like a collectivity. But not looking all the person on one painting, that's idolatry, like an idol. But the contrary, four paintings, like in Washington, in the work of room, and you are alone in the middle. And you feel that something from the message is surrounding you, no way to escape. Or you are in the middle and you are the four painting. How did he decide to change the style we know from the first period, which was very figurative, with the persons in the street or women at the window, or after that, plants in the water or surrealistic paintings, which was at this period, everybody was surrealist, and Rothko also was surrealist. He was looking for a way to do it. Happened something. And that's the private Rothko story. What happened? In 1947, 48, his mother died. That's an event for a guy like Rothko, because his father died soon. The moment he arrived in America, his father died 6 months after that. He was without father. It happens to a lot of persons. They immigrate from here, they were not in their country, they were lost, and the mother died in 1949. Second event, that's the Holocaust, the genocide. How we know? At the beginning, nobody was interested with this question, but I was interested. The influence of the Holocaust on Rothko, because we know nothing. He spoke very little about that, very little. He's not saying that it was not disturbing, but he spoke about it. But I know more or less what is the problem, my private life. My mother was born here in Belarus. It's a pity because if I want to visit Belarus, it's a full time job. But I'm coming from a part of my family here, from here. And she was in concentration camp, and her family was killed in Gotchani. It's close to, between Vilnius and Minsk. I know that. But what is the connection with Rothko? I have to find it. And I found three or four occurrences when he said very strange things. Very strange. Do you know the painter by the name of Soulages? Oh, completely black paintings. He's still alive, and it's a wonderful, huge painting, completely black. It tells you something? No. He's very French, but he's very famous now, everywhere. When Soulages went to visit the American painter, Pollock, Motherwell, Rothko, all these painters were drinking together all the day. Painters are drinking. Why? Because they are all the day alone in their atelier. They have nobody to shout against. They have nobody to be nervous against. They are alone. If you are an actor, if you are a filmmaker, you can say, I have a beautiful idea, but because of the cameraman, it's bullshit. It's not good. Or because of the sound engineer. You can say to everybody, it's because of you. When you are a painter, you are alone. When you are going out of the atelier, you are drinking, generally. And they were drinking together. Rothko was drinking a lot, vodka, maybe vodka. became to be very famous. It was at the end of the 40s, 48, 49, flying. And the show, they introduced Soulages, a French painter, painting completely in black. And they say to Marc Rothko, "Marc Rothko, this is Soulages, a French painter." And Rothko said to him, "Oh, Europe, Europe, I have seen so many Christ with blood, so many Pietà with blood, and concentration camps, and you killed the Jews." And the poor Soulages, who was only a painter, said, "What's happening to me? Why is he saying to me all these things? Because I'm not part of this." He was a painter, not in charge of the order of Christ. Okay. That's one way, but the only one. We know that he was disturbed with the question. Very few persons of his family were killed here because they escaped to America. But some of them, yes. Some of them, yes. And then another, Louis Bourgeois, which is a sculptress, said about Marc Rothko, he's like a rabbi. He's always speaking about the world and not about himself. Saying, making general sentence. He wrote a book also, The Reality of the Artist, of Art, and he never said that he's a painter in the book. Only ideas. He, 1 year he spent to write his book about the job of an artist. It's a good book. What is an artist? A lot of information. Yeah. But he never said, "I wrote this book and I'm myself an artist." He was by himself a very abstract guy, disturbed by the genocide. Very disturbed. And third point, he knew Hebrew very well. He wrote poetry and novels, books in Hebrew. After he was 25, 30, so many years after he left the school. So, not everybody in Chagat didn't know anything in Hebrew. Nothing to, they were Jew, but not like rabbi, not like, and he take a decision when everybody, all the group of the painter, Pollock, Motherwell, Klein, and all the others, decided to have their own way. It may happen to you, I hope so. You have to decide to have your personal way, how to paint, or how to make sculpture. Not to make like the others, but your own way to do. To pick in the Bible and in the Jewish mysticism the clues how to work. And that made two huge changes. I'm going to tell you something about changing. Till the multiform period, you may see blurry paintings. You know what is blurry? Form. Like you have here all the year. You can't see anything. And I came here for the first time and said, "Oh, that's what cool. It's we are in a cloud all the time." This way to be blurry, not to paint in a very, like Mondrian or other, in a very clean way, like the Holland painting, but to have like in a cloud. That was not in the first painting. You can't see it in the first painting. That was a decision he took 46, 47, 48. He became to paint in a blurry way. Some of them say that because he has problem with the view. He was short sighted. He has problem with your sunglasses like that. But that's a joke. That's a decision. The second decision was to organize the column like figures, like in the theater. Rothko used to work as an actor. I know the job also, that's why I have some way to work. I was in charge of the National Theater in France for 15 years. And an actor with the colors, It's very important that it is not the same way than the other way to use color. And I'm going to tell you some words about it. You may use colors because you feel the colors. You feel in a red mood, or you feel in a yellow mood. Yellow, I don't know what is this mood, but let's say you are in a yellow atmosphere, or in a black atmosphere, or in a white atmosphere. That's you. You express yourself with a color. That's a kind of telling how do you feel. You are depressed, it's maroon. You are happy, it's red. You are making what you want. But that's a language like with a flower, the language of the colors. That's one way. The other way is there are a lot of works have been made at the beginning of the 20th century, the end of the 19th, of the rules of the color. What are, which color fits good with the other one? Because you have rules. It was like a scientific way to put the color together. You have rules. You cut, you put red with blue, or blue with yellow, and you have like Steiner. You don't know if you know Steiner, but now the person who are not eating meat, and they are very close to this the Steiner way. The children in the school are making paintings to express themselves in a Steiner way. And in this case, like Schopenhauer or Goethe, who wrote about the colors, Schopenhauer, Goethe, the two philosophers, wrote about colors. The colors are scientific rules. If you put colors on a frame, or you express yourself, or you use the rules. If you put blue, you say, you know that you have to put another color which fits or not, which is contradictory or going with it. Rothko said all the time, but nobody wanted to listen, because if you don't want to listen, you don't want to listen. You go, yeah, yeah. You don't understand, and you don't say, and you say, okay, I don't care. No. I'm not a colorist. I'm not saying that. He said that all the time. I'm not a colorist. I'm not expressing myself. All the persons who are writing a lot about the mood, how do you feel in front of a painting of a painting. It's not false, because Rothko say, a person who are crying in front of my painting, I know that I found it. But he was very depressed there. And he, very soon, he understands that nobody is understanding what he did. And he said, okay, the minimum, if they don't understand, let's have emotion. If you don't understand, emotion is no way. For what cause? The best is to understand. But if you don't understand, you may have emotion. You don't know why, but okay, you are. But in fact, he was not expressing himself. He said many times, I'm not telling something about myself. That's why also he laughs about it. I'm not telling something about myself. And that's the second point. I'm not using the rules of the color as what he does. What was the days you work, if not expression, private expression, and if not scientific rules? The colors in the Judaism, in the Jewish mysticism, they knew that because he used to teach in a Jewish school till 53, 23 years. He was teaching painting to Jewish person, Jewish children. They knew more or less very few about Bible, but it was a Jewish school full of rabbis. I was there in New York. He was not a Jew, it's important, because he was born Jew. He was a professor, not Jew. Jew was his job. And because of this, he knew the material. And he knew something very important, which is Jewish mysticism. And what is Kabbalah? And what is Jewish mysticism? In the Jewish mysticism, we have a big part dealing with the language of the colors, like in the Bible. And what are they saying? They are saying that colors are telling something about the world, not about the painter, and not about himself, like a scientist, but about the world. They are figures, and you use this kind of figures, the colors, to tell the story of another world. Information coming from somewhere. Chagall more or less knew that when he made the vitrage, the windows. Mm-hmm. But he made it copying the Bible. Rothko was not copying the Bible. Rothko said, colors, I take a painting and I put, let's say, blue. It's somebody which is telling something, like on a stage, a theater. You have the first actor. You are looking at the actor, that's what the way he was working. And he said that. I said, okay, with this actor, I may have another one. And he said, you, come in. Blue, yellow. Yellow is coming. And he see the relationship between blue and yellow. On this painting, not on all the painting of the world, on this painting. He say, okay, we need a third one, because if they are together, there's nothing to say. And after that, who is important, who is not important, who is large, who is not large, depends on the three colors. Like on the stage, you have three actors, you are looking, and you say, oh, I have the feeling that it works well when this girl is here, this guy is there, and the other one is saying nothing, or very few. And he said that. He said, my frames are staged. A stage like in a theater. I say to the colors, go in, once after the other, and after that I make a regulation. Who is important? Who is not important? What kind of relationship, like human being, what kind of relationship they have? And that's why the paintings are so strong, because they are not, in fact, abstract, formalist way. You see figures dealing with one of two, like human beings. And you say, oh, this group, they seem to be important. They have a nice life or a crisis, like three person. One is opposite to the two other. Oh, and this question, using the colors, like figures in the theater, and information of the world above, telling the story about another reality, that's the way he was using paintings. Why it's difficult to deal with this? You need to know Judaism, mysticism, and the theory of the colors in Judaism and mysticism. That's a full tangent. But if you know a little bit about that, you may read in English or read in French. So.
One color has same meaning in each painting or meanings are different?
It has to be main meaning. Like you take an actor. You have an actor which is tall, blonde, with blue eyes. He's going to be, I don't know, you call it in English, Jean Fromm. It's a beautiful guy in the movie. But if you put him in another movie, he's playing another role, but it's the same. It's the same girl. It's a good idea to ask, but it's not in the same situation. And how he made a painting? Let's go further. First, he covered completely the stage, the painting, canvas, with one color, only one. That's the ground. And after, he put on this the stage, on this canvas, the other colors coming. And you can feel, when you are looking at even the two paintings out there, that there is one color behind, not a lot of color, only one. There is a unity, and on this unity, you can move. You are on a stage, there is one stage, one world, one humanity, one, there is one. But the difference are gave by the colors. And one more thing, the relationship between the colors, you know, you can see, are blurry. It's not a line. It's like a cloud. The relation between persons are blurry. The relation are not clear relation. You are one close to another, even if it's your husband, your boyfriend, but you are not the same, and you are not close. You are in a no man's land, which is like a cloud, and your relation between you as a color, as a figure, and your friend as a color, as a figure, is blurry, is a fog. All these ideas, relation between each other, relation with the ground, it took from the Bible, and I don't know, is it somebody who read the Bible now? It's very difficult to come with a new generation. Somebody knows the Bible now? But you have seen probably the film, the Ten Commandments, maybe Charlton Heston, but Moses, even not. It was a very successful film, Hollywood film in this case. The moment Moses went to meet God, it's a story. I wasn't there, I'm not sure it happened. But in the story, he went and climbed on the mountain and he received the law from God. He's not seeing God. He can't see. He is a cloud. And through the cloud, he can hear. The cloud gives the opportunity, this blurry, gives the opportunity to have a meeting, not to touch, to feel that somebody is close, but you are not, you are not sure. Maybe there is something, because you can see. And you have all in the Bible, all the beginning, the five first book, God is a cloud. It may happen. Sometimes God is a figure, but Judaism is not dealing with pantheism, with gods who can figure. It's forbidden. It's forbidden to have images in Judaism. It's forbidden to have images in Islam. You know that? It's forbidden to have images in Protestant and religion. Only the Christian, which is a question, I leave it for questions. Only the Christian thinks that images brings you to God. The only one. When I spoke and made lectures to Christian, they said, what? We are the only one? I said, yes, the Jews not, the Muslim not, the Protestant not. You are the only one putting images all the, everywhere and say each image is a way to the upper information, God. Christ, God, the Jews not, the Muslim not, and Jews and Muslim are quite close on this question. So you can see God, but he is here. And that's why we can say that Rothko is a spiritual painting. Not because he is painting God, but he is giving, like Levinas, the philosopher, who was born in Kaunas, says, God is coming to you as an idea. He's not here, but you have the idea that he may be there. What is God? I never met. That's the idea that there is something than me, which is more important than you. The new generation, nobody is more important than me. Everybody thinks he's the most important person in the world. And he has all the information, all the tatouage and everything. He is the person important in a, and there is no other. But when you have a population which is living together, or when you have even two persons, a woman and a guy, or two women, or two guys, now you have to make all the figures possible, but you are two, not only one, you know that you need something that's making you together. If you are alone, you're alone. Care about anybody, and you say, I'm living as I want. But if you are a group, you need to have something which makes you together. For a religious person, the what makes you together? That's the idea of God. Because God is not coming and telling you, oh, you're right, you're making jealousy. It never happened. For Christians, sometimes they say, I speak to God by screaming, but the Jews not. And the Muslim atonement. Never any Muslim is going to say, I spoke to God, and God spoke to me. God is somewhere, I don't know. We have no information, and he's not giving you any. That is to say that the spiritual question is the idea that something organized, that's a bad word, is there. And why organized? Because we are not organized. We are human, poor human guys and women, completely disorganized, with our own problems, and trying to put the problem we have to another, and making problems to the parents, making problems to the friends. We are disorganized. You know the Woody Allen film? Maybe with Woody Allen? A little bit, yes. Disorganized, like this guy. But there is a place where something is organized. That's rock of paintings and Judaism. How does it work in rock of painting? I say the background is one color. It's organized. After that, you have colors who are dealing with each other. But the background, it's not only. At the same moment, when you decide to have these colors trying to live together, that's a question. How can I live with somebody else? The moment they decided, he decided, he also made all these paintings till today, till the last one, symmetrical.
Bottom.
Pardon? Symmetrical in the middle.
Bottom.
Sorry? Human. Bottom. Oh, no, Barney Human is a very boring painter. I don't want to speak about that. It was a friend of Rothko. But Rothko, if you see all the painting from 49, the abstract paintings, they are symmetrical. And I add, yes, can you try?
Sure.
They are symmetrical. Even the black and white.
Yeah.
And third thing, they give you energy. If you have a painting, a good one, not all, you are here, two which are quite good. They give you energy. And I have to tell you a story. No, no, it's okay. After that, you're going to ask questions or not. When I went to make the movie, I went to a museum in Switzerland, Basel, and the Beyeler Foundation, very, very beautiful museum. And I spoke with Beyeler, the person who made the museum, because he met Marco. And I want to have information how it happened, his opinion, because Marco was there. I need a person who knew me. And I went to the museum, it was 11 o'clock in the morning, and there was a woman sitting in front of a rock of paper. Yeah. I spoke with Beyeler, he told me stupid thing. Walker was drinking on the time vodka, he won't blinds when you are meeting. I said, okay, it's very interesting, eating blinds. But tell me something about the paintings, because he's in charge of a museum, not of a pizzeria. And but he didn't want to say anything about other things that you call it anime, few things.
Mm-hmm.
And I went out of this restaurant, of the museum. It was 3 o'clock afternoon, and I planned to go back to Paris. I went to have a look for the last time of the painting, because we're a Rothko room with paintings. And the woman was there from 11. To 3 o'clock, 4 hours, sitting in front of the rock of painting. I sat on the side and I asked her, you feel better? And she said, I feel much better. And it was a rock of therapy, a background, unique, symmetrical in the middle, which organized you, and light, color light. That's the reason he keep the symmetry movement. He put out the colors. A lot of persons say, that's not right, that he put out the calls because he was depressed. He was all the time depressed. And you know that painters may be depressed and make very colorful paintings. You are depressed, but you are making paintings with colors. The decision to have black and gray painting, which is the last period, was because he said that, not me. I have the feeling that the person thinks that I am decorative. It's beautiful, you have a work in the salon. It's a beautiful and decorative. But I don't want to be decorative. I have something to say. And why I am decorative? Because of the colors. I say, I put out the colors, and now we have the idea, the naked idea, the idea itself. The friends of Marc Rothko say, you are becoming foolish, we don't like this painting, we don't want to be more your friend, you know, people maybe like that. And if you have seen in my film the Rothko Chapel, the Rothko Chapel is completely black, not black, but maroon, very dark, if you remember, and no colors. And that was also the same period. He put out the colors. Rothko is very famous because of the colors, but when I made my film, the box of my film is this Rothko. I like very much because it's quite no colors. Quite. There is color. Quite not. What did he keep? He kept symmetrical and a round. Unit round. That he took from Judaism. He took also something else from Judaism. And I want to show it if you, I hope you remember, how this looks, the work of chapel. It's a chapel with a flat roof. Without this, that the project of the chapel, the architect made. The chapel of Houston, the University St. Thomas, which is a Christian name, asked Rothko to make a chapel, a religious place. And because it's a religious place, the architect said, we are going to have this, because in the church you have this part. Rothko fought with the architect. Rothko was a very difficult person to live with. And he disturbed so much the architect said, okay, bye, I'm in. Then the same architect who made the restaurant, also for the person who remember my film, there is a part in the restaurant, Philip Johnson. And I show the places where Rothko was working. And this Philip Johnson said, okay, I'm fed up. Bye. And now you are making the chapel yourself. And what did he make? He put this away. The moment he put this away, the chapel has a flat roof. For a Christian place, a flat roof with no Christ, with no place to pray, with no windows. There's no windows in the chapel. It's completely dark. The university, and he committed suicide. He died. Before it was inaugurated. A few months before it was inaugurated. And yeah, that's also the same problem. Never happened. What did he say? He said, in my religion, the spiritual transcendence, the world is a philosophical world, is not with the eye upstairs, but here. It is the other person. The other person, that's also the philosophy of Levinas, the other person is the person who gives you spirituality. You are in charge of the person which is in front of you and not in the skies. But how can you explain it to the St. Thomas, the person who asked him for a chapel? It was impossible. He said to them, do you know that you are you are asking me to make a chapel, a Christian chapel, but I'm not Christian at all. I'm Jew, I was taking my mother to the synagogue all the time, it wasn't true. But he wanted to say, be careful, I'm not with the same spirit. We want a chapel, but I'm not in the mood to make a Christian chapel. I don't know how, I don't like the Christian chapel. Okay. The chapel is flat, and I have to finish the story, because it's not a story, it's really reality, but I like it, it's an anecdote. The moment they have this chapel, and Rothko is dead in 1970, what to do with this? Impossible to make a church. They say, oh, we know a person, it's in Houston, Texas. It was in 1970, many years ago. We know a person who may be interested in this place, Muslims. Because Muslims, they don't need this kind of flesh arrow on the in the mosque. They don't have it. And they will be happy to pray here. But in this period, Muslims, you have very few Muslims. It was a period with no Muslims. But they find a small group, and they say, that's for you, you can pray here. They came here, and if you remember the chapel, you have seen it here on my film, it's not a place you are very happy to pray. It's black and a little bit light. You came with a good atmosphere, and you go out depressed. That's what happened to my crew, the film, and after half an hour, they say we want to go outside a little bit to have fresh air. And even for Muslims, it was not good. They think a lot, the Muslims say, okay, take back the chapel. And they think what to do, and they say, oh, we know who is going to say yes, we are very happy with the chapel. The Buddhist, because the Buddhist, they are praying in very empty places. And they don't care about the world. And it's not important. And the Buddhists used to pray there for 2 or 3 years. And after that, they were fed up also. Because you have nothing to grab. You can, when you're praying, I don't know if you are praying probably not. Me too not. But you have to look at the world. If you are in a church, you are looking at Jesus or the story. The time is shorter. There's nothing on the wall, nowhere to look. Even a Buddhist was depressed. And they gave back the chapel, and now they have electroacoustic concert music, electroacoustic music. Okay, it's good. It's boring and that's it. But what is important, more than the animal, that they call it transcendence in philosophy, is horizontal in Judaism and not upstairs. That's Christian. Jesus went to the sky, he was the Son of God, there was a connection between the sky and the earth. In Judaism, nobody went to the sky. We have no resurrection of the dead, not expectation of something which is coming to be. A writer by the name of Singer, I like him very much, I made a film about him, Isaac Bashevis Singer. They asked him, do the Jews believe in resurrection? And he said, yes, we believe in resurrection, but it never happened. It's the idea of things are horizontal, and in front of you, you have what you have to deal with. That's Rothko explained it in a very clear way. He said, I want to give to the viewer the feeling that's big. You have not the painting huge, but are taking you and saying, come, come. In your arm. The painting are taking you in your arm. You have a relation with the painting, like a friend, like somebody you don't know exactly who he is, because when you have a friend who don't know exactly who he is, maybe you say you think he's a good friend, and after many years he tries to kill you. We don't know exactly who is every person. That's just the same with a painting. You have to be at the one. He wrote it down every place. He said the painting has to be low. I don't want a painting high like a museum, but low. And it never happened. It happened in New York, in Washington, but generally they don't care. They know that if the painting is low, person are going to destroy the painting. They put fire. But paint, the painting has to be low, and at a distance, you can feel that you are in relation with the painting, because it's a big painting. You are in relation with the painting, and you say, I have a friend. I make a relationship. That's what I say. I said in bad English because of the lecture, but he said the paintings are a way to have relation. And relation with what? Relation with something else. And here is a philosophy that I'm not going to tell you of another guy from this area, Levinas, saying what makes you a spiritual person is a relationship with somebody else. Not God, and not you alone. But the fact that they are... I'm going to finish in 5 minutes, not because of them, but because of everybody, and if you have questions about them. You have to think about that. Even if you don't know Judaism, you don't know mysticism, Jewish mysticism, not Christian mysticism, Jewish mysticism. But that use this kind of horizontality, structuration, that is to say, I'm a lost guy, but the world not. The world is very well organized, so, which is a contrary of Christian philosophy and nowadays philosophy, which is more than Christian, that you may have the feeling that if you say something, it's going to happen. You are giving order to the reality. Okay? You call it make politics, if you make politics. You say, we made a decision, and the reality is going to do like we decide. And I ask them, but it was only words. You say, I don't know, things are going to be better. And I say, it's its word. How are you managing to have things better? Say, we decided, we made politics. In today, the world is organized, and we are a little bit foolish, the guy, the persons. And we may be organized by the world, by science, by mysticism, by alchemia. We are dealing with the color and the alchemia, how do you call it? Alchemia. That's why, if you may stay, and I finish with this, you may stay in front of a work of painting, a big one. They are big. Yeah, but not big enough. You need the huge one. That's why in my film I put them close to a window to understand that they are very, very big. You are staying in front of this painting, and this painting is telling you how the world is, or how the group of the person who are the colors are. And you say that you have friends, you have the feeling that you have friends, and that you have in harmony with the world, not with you. The more you are disturbed, I have seen it many years, the more you are disturbed personally, the more you like God. Mm-hmm. I have seen it many times. Person said to me, I love God, I'm going to visit the exhibition there. I say, okay, poor person. Because you are in front of you, the proposal of Marc Rocco to organize in a philosophical way and sensitive way an image of the world which is like philosophy to make unit everybody. Okay, that's for me enough. In this case, it's not Chagat in this case. And if you want to read more, the reality and its shadow. It's a text from Levinas about art, which is wonderful. I don't remember if Christopher Walker, the son of the painter, made the lecture, because he's reading French, if he had an English version, perhaps, made on French. And you have a lot of artists from Baltic country here, Jews, who are dealing with this question. And Sosnot, which is from Riga, was a sculpture, saying a sculpture don't have to be finished. You need to have the feeling that you may finish it, that you are part of the job. And the same with the rock painting, because they are blurry, like in fog, you may have the feeling that you may finish it. That's your job to finish it, to feel how to finish it. If the painting is completely finished, you know, like a Holland painting, you have nothing to do. Only to say, oh, yeah, wonderful. And workers say no. That's the philosophy of Emmanuel Levinas. In my book, I don't read it very complicated. Totality and infinite, totality and infinite. You say that you have to avoid totality to get the feeling of the infinite. If you avoid totality, you may be open to something else, to life.
Okay.
It's enough. if you want to pay, ask question, I'm ready. If not, let's have a break.
It's not even a question. I'm a little bit shocked listening by your presentation today, because we get used to think about Oscar that he wrote many times himself that I'm not a colorist.
That's right.
I'm interested only in expressing basic human emotions and feelings. And you talk now that he is not expressing. He is making this...
He is expressing, but not his own feelings. But that's quite complicated. Rocco was a tricky person. He knew that when he's giving explanation from time to time, nobody was understanding the question. You know what? I'm not Rocco, I am exactly the same. When I'm teaching philosophy, I know because I'm teaching from time to time, all the time. Also today, it's a waste of time. Nobody understands. And I gave a lecture here. I tried. Who remember? It was many years ago. That's why you have to say something. The emotion is a way to catch somebody, to keep it to the painting, to say, oh, come here. But I don't have, I don't make things like that if Rocco was all his life painting very beautiful color filled paintings. But why I feel like him, and I understand, that he decided to put away the colors and not to play on the emotion. He said, subtle emotion, whoa. He was very famous, you know that. And a very rich person were buying work of paintings to put in the salon, to put in, because it's expensive, you know. And I say, okay, he decided, no. I stopped with it. And there is something else. He was reading philosophy, and Platon, which is Platon, the continuation, which is a philosopher, very boring, but okay, he wrote black, make you think. That's a color that makes you think, not red, blue, but black. I'm sure that he decided to go to black to oblige the person to think. It was not so successful, but that's what it's like, you know, to be an artist and to everybody understand you. That's only if you make flowers and landscape, and even that, but the other, no.
It's famous that Marcos was one of the most intellectual artists of the 20th century.
Yes, but it has to be somewhere in the painting. It's not enough to say that.
Yes.
Okay. You mentioned about his connection with Plato, Platon.
I'm sorry?
You mentioned his connection with Plato, Platon.
Yes.
Yes. And at the beginning of the lecture, you said something about the collectiveness, yeah? How would you formulate? What is Plato's influence, main influence, besides the Black Arthur column? Main influence upon Rothko? Plato's main influence.
Can you formulate? I forget, don't believe that I understand everything in English.
Can you formulate? What is Plato's main influence on Rothko?
Ah.
Besides the Black Arthur.
I'm going to make it a bit simple, as I feel.
Yeah.
Rothko was an ambiguous person, and that's not only because of him. He was from an assimilated family. His father and mother were have a chemistry here.
A pharmacy.
To have a pharmacy in this period, and you can see in the photo, they were dressed like Latvian bourgeois, not like a Jew. They are not a religious way. And the story of Rothko is partial. The story of the Jews who suffered because they didn't succeed to assimilate. Because of anti-Semitism, because of the war, they were on the way to become like everybody. But they didn't succeed because why did they left here? The first revolution in 1905, Russian revolution, frightened the family. The three children, older children, brothers and sisters of Rothko. They went to the normal school, a school like a non-Jewish school, and they put Rothko in a Jewish school because they decided that, okay, they tried to be like everybody, which is impossible. And they put the last guy in a Jewish school. Rothko is on the cross of a normal life. We can see, if you are interested on television, that they were born. I gave you a name. We have in Paris a friend of mine, a very important person, which was minister in the government, who raised Médecins du Monde, which is an organization dealing with doctors in all around the world, by the name of Bernard Kouchner. Kouchner is his grandfather was born in. The way that we have a very famous person who was born in France, was born in Denmark. The way he became involved in the French society, we call it assimilation. It was communist, but more or less. Rothko knew Hebrew, and because of this, he was on one side. Trying to be one like the others, and you can see it on all the period of the mythologic painting. He said, I use the myth like a universal language. And the universal language connects Rothko to all the world. You know, the Greek, that's like I'm like one of the others. The moment he decided to be Jew, at the moment he didn't succeed. Not only him, but everybody, because of the Holocaust, because of everything. He said it's impossible to be one or the other. And he used the other part. Platon is from the part of assimilation, of philosophy, and everything. And maybe, here I have to say, that's my opinion, it's not a hand. At the end of his life, when he went to black and gray paintings, when he changed completely and put away the colors, it's also because he said, with Judaism, I am going nowhere. I have to return to a universal language. And return, like he, when he was painting the mythology. All his first period is universal. He is painting like everybody, let's say. And he decided to close the period of Judaism and went to philosophy. And in this case, he returned to Platon. And it's possible because I have a lot of friends, not one, but a lot. I met a few months ago about one of them, which was the secretary of Jean-Paul Sartre, the French philosopher, who were in the universal fighting. They were French revolutionaries, you know, on the barricade and things like that, leftist. After that, they became very religious Jews, and one of them, Benny Levy, was dealing with Sartre all the day, was his secretary about that. Sartre was not Jew, but he was discussing about that. And at the end of his life, trying to go back to Platon, saying, okay, enough with making everybody fed up with this Jewish question and Judaism. If I want to have an audience, if I want to people speak to me, understand me, I have to go back to Platon. I have the feeling that it was what happened to Walker, that I have the proof. That for me, the moment he decided to go from colors to black and white, that's the moment he decided to go to Platon. And that's why you have some attitudes. No? You don't have one attitude, it's a complex idea. Complex in a story that a lot of persons don't understand, because nobody need to understand the story of the Jews after the war. That's a very specific problem.
If you were speaking that in his Judaic period, that we can't see the face of God, it's always hidden by way of mystery. Yeah. And Rothko painted this blurry color fields like waves.
Yeah, like that, yeah.
And can we take his images like icons without image?
That was an idea, because it came from a place where you have icons, the Orthodox religions. And I have no idea, because I didn't read anything from Morocco about, I need to say a lot of things, or person saying yes or no, but what can I do with everybody with his opinion? But I have no clue saying that he was interested with the icons. The Orthodox icon. But there is one thing which may you say yes, that icons are two-dimensional. In the work of painting, right. Yeah. You have no the three dimension, never. No perspective. Never perspective. And he said that the decision to have perspective in the Renaissance, in the Italian painting, was a big mistake. It destroyed the painting, the perspective, making the painting like a photography, and the spiritual life of an image was destroyed. That we know, because he was twice in Italy, and he went and saw a lot of paintings. He was very interested with the Italian painting. But he was not, like, he's not the only one. Some of our art specialists say that the painting, the painter, was destroyed the moment you decide to have perspective. Before you have perspective, you are dealing with a problem. How to give spirituality to the two-dimensional plan. The moment you have perspective, you are disturbed by the question of resemblance of you have to be to look like to look the same. The moment you are disturbed with the question, how do I work? Because I want that it looks the same. Holland painting, you say, oh, this girl is a pearl. She's like, she's here. You know, you want to say, I have seen her. It's here. You can speak with her. It's life. But is in the tradition, essentially, it's a good question for me. the question I may answer, this question that I may answer. That's the idea of going with perspectives. He was very hostile, actually. But Pollock also, and Klein also, and all the American guys were painting with no perspective. And you know, have to remind my film over the have to see it more than one time. But at the beginning, when I show the first aquarium, I said that there is no perspective. That's the first thing we can see on the first works of Rothko is making an aquarium, and we can see a forest, perhaps a forest here. It was in the States, but to remind the forest, and there is no perspective. That is to say that perspective is not a progress. And in this case, icons may be a good way to deal with this question.
Did you see his poems written in Hebrew?
Yeah. Yeah, the family decided to show the Hebrew text for the first time in Warsaw, in Poland, Warsaw, yes. Warsaw, it's in Warsaw. And I was there. I made two lectures, one at the opening and one at the end. It was very nice, but I have not the feeling that anybody was forceful, and it was translated in Polish in every good condition. But only going to the Western world is only my good impression I had. But I gave two lectures. That was the best situation, one at the first day and one at the last day. I came back. And the family gave the Hebrew poem, probably before they say, okay, maybe disturbing, you know. We don't know what, I'm sorry to tell that you, because you're our country, where so many Jews were there. I know so many persons who were, their parents were born there, in Latvia, in Estonia, my mother. But for you, you are the young generation. It's a story which is has no impact, because you can't even meet the person who were there for the beginning. Where we have seen in Vilnius, the person who said, my family was there for three or four generations. And I say, yes, but you are a lot of like that. He said, no, I don't know, more or less. This story, you have to deal it very carefully because of the way to understand it. That if you have no clue to go further, to read the books, and Levinas is the same, you are going to know to talk about Levinas in Vilnius, and not about the cycle. But it was a colloquium in Tours about this item a few months ago. I have nothing to say. It's difficult, it's a full-time job. Maybe it's not so useful because the painting of Rothko are so strong that you don't need explanation. But I'm fighting not because the person I give bad explanation. That's my main concern, but you can give that explanation.
Any questions? Thank you so much.
It's in French, but perhaps Levinas faces the beauty. That's a text dealing with the question of beauty with this philosopher. Levinas from Carnot, Cornas, and he said that art is not moving you upstairs, but downstairs. It's been a conference, it's finished. I'm not giving you more information, but you have to know that person coming from this area, you have to check why. Where against figuration, speaking that art, you have to be very difficult and clever. there a way if you want to tell something? And the same with Julien, because Julien was an intellectual, with young videos.
Thank you.